Assalamualaikum and a very good afternoon to all participants. Welcome to today's talk for the Environment and Water Week Lecture Series 2. So today is the second day of the event and this is the second slot. And today we are honored to have Mr. Muhammad Haizah bin Ngah as the invited speaker. A little bit of a biodata of the speaker. Mr. Haizah received his degree in computer software engineering from University Putra Malaysia in 2003. His expertise areas include waste to material and waste to energy from landfill and also green technology. He is a former director at Angkasa Kowaris Plastics Nyabarhat and the founder of IT Mark Technologies Nyabarhat. He has 10 years experience in information technology and software engineering, 2 years in government sector, and 8 years in oil and gas related company. Currently, Mr. Muhammad Haizah is the CEO at Techno Reconsulting Nyabarhat, located at Selangor, Malaysia. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Mr. Haizah to present the talk entitled Material for Future Sustainability. So dipersilakan Encik Haizah.
Okay, thank you Dr. Nur Aini Muhammad Arish for this opening explanation of my background. So basically, on this evening, very thanks to UDHM, especially the faculty mechanical, is it? Yeah. And for the invitations in this speech in Environment and Water Week Lecture Series 2.0. So, ladies and gentlemen, today is asked by the organizer to present the material for future sustainability. All right. Okay, it's a very it's quite fear in front of the students, and hopefully I can control my fear. And because I'm from the background, I'm not basically an engineering student, but because of the passion in this environmental, it's bring me to until this stage, bring the technology consulting Serambahat into a landfills management or smart material recovery and waste to material and waste to energy business. So before I start my presentations, I want to bring back to 2008, a film made by Pixar Animation and led Walt Disney picture is Wall-E. I think, I don't know whether, I think all the rest of the audience is, I'm not sure whether you're familiar with these animations. It's created by the Andrew Staton. Let me play with the video. It's something that actually I want to relate to our topic today. All right, this is a Wall-E. Wall-E is the robot sent from the galaxy to Earth to look for the Sith. All right, so this animation created in 2008 by Andrew Staton. Imagine in the next 700 years, what will happen to the Earth? Thank you. imagination of this creator for creator is there's no human can live in the in this earth in next 700 years. So Wall-E is the machines that created to resolve the problem of the pollution from the waste or solid waste. Basically, in this story, Eva is back to his galaxy without the city, and he thought his mission is failed. But unfortunately, luckily, Wall-E found the seedling, and together with Eva back to the galaxies and bring the seed. All right, so let's go to the end of the story lah. If not, it take 1.5 hours and finish my presentation. Okay. So finally, what was happened is
this is called farming. You kids are going to grow all kinds of plants. Vegetable plants, pizza plants. It's good to be home.
So maybe everybody can type in the chat board the lesson learned from this story. Maybe we can share. I think maybe because this evening is 2 PM, 2:30, as everybody start to maybe sleepy, we give some tasks and maybe can type anything that basically relates to this story, it giving me ideas in my next presentation. All right, this one is the is our main my main main topics that I want to show. Basically, I don't want to emphasize a lot of the statistics, but it's just to open our mind that in 2030, in Southeast Asia itself will generate 466 million ton of MSW, and it will be increasing to 661 MSW, and will generate 2.01 billion tons of municipal waste annually, and targeting expecting to grow up to 3.4 billion ton in 2050. I think we don't need to wait for 700 years in future. We may need to, maybe 2050, we can reach up to what Andrew Staten think that Malaysia world will be full with the MSW. But things that I want to bring all all this audience is how we can imagine that this 2.01 billion ton annually generated is equivalent to 210 hectometers of MSW. So from this land area, I searched from Google, the land area for Malaysia is around 32 million hectare, and Singapore itself is 72,800 hectare. So it's already can cover Singapore, it's maybe three times of Singapore annually, MSW. So maybe next year, if they say all the world generate MSW dump into Singapore, we can have next Wall-E animation in Singapore. This is imagine every 3 years, every year we lost the country like Singapore three times. So it's a very important for us to understand that this problem is actually a very big problem for our world and also Malaysia. And this is the sum composition of the waste generated. It's around 1.6 billion ton CO2, GHG emission was generated from generated, but in 5% it basically is from landfill, and from the landfills. So food waste is they account the food waste generate more than 50% emissions from the methane gas production and so on from the landfills. And the other thing is the waste not just only at land but also at ocean. So in statistic, world generate 300 million tons of plastic or produce 300 million tons of plastic, and 40 million tons is end up in the ocean every year. So 14 million tons, if we equivalent to 14 million meter cube, then we can estimate around maybe is equivalent to Negeri Sembilan maybe. So it's a huge number of waste dumped to the oceans, and basically the plastic pollution is a problem, affect the ocean health, of course. The fish and all the species inside the marines, and also the food safety, of course, because our fish start to eat the plastics and affect our body. And again, I think I don't need to emphasize on this, but it's just to remain and recall back the negative impact of our MSW. So it's a promote a microorganism, and as we know, there are most of the virus is dumped into that landfill. Recently is the virus COVID-19. But most of our masks will be thrown in at our bin and up to the landfill. So the odors, the quality of environment, pollution, and also occupation of space that could be used for other purposes. So our experience in Kuantan, the government allocate around 60 hectares of land for MSW. So 60 acres of land, I'm not sure there are many houses that we can develop, or maybe we can have a township utilizing that that can utilize the allocated land for MSW landfill. This is a component of solid waste. I think it just nobody can claim that their statistic is right. Even in Malaysia, it's very hard to have this accurate statistic, except until we have a separation. But in generally in landfill, we can have a plastic paper, but normally when paper is inside the landfill is turned into soil normally, and there is three general components that we can see from the landfill is rubber, metal, glass, and the other thing is plastic and also compost soil, right? And the other things is I want to bring about our forest, because our topic is the material. World basically their forecast 30% of 31% of the global land area is a forest. The total forest area is around 4.6 billion hectares, but more than world forests are from these five countries: Brazil, Canada, United States, America, and China. And the rest is from none of these five countries, including Malaysia and Indonesia. But things I want to bring all the audience is in 2015 and 2020, the deforestation was estimated at 10 million hectares per year, down from 60 million hectares per year in 1990. So again, I want to bring some ideas how this forest deforestation affect us. Imagine that deforestation of 10 million hectares per year is equivalent to 10 million, is equivalent to 10 million hectares per year is equivalent to maybe whole of Peninsula Malaysia, probably. So Malaysia is 32 million, and the deforestation yearly is 10 million, maybe covered on Peninsula Malaysia, except so every year. Or we can imagine that the whole of our forest in Peninsula gone. So from these activities, so things that basically very important to understand that forest bring us oxygen. So imagine that we'll live without oxygen, then it's back to my first slide. It's Wall-E. We have to. Maybe we have to go to the galaxies to live. All right. In Malaysia, the deforestation is Malaysian deforestation rate and statistic is around 20.3 million hectares of natural forest. All right, extending over 87% of its land area. So in total, Malaysia deforestation rate statistic in 2020 is already 20.3 million hectares. Is the contribution is may come from the agriculture activities, urban activities, and so on for human livings. But most of the time, that basically our worry is the manipulations from the. From the activities is because it's some of the license is for agriculture, but finally end up is just only deforestation without any agriculture activities. So it's a very important material. It's a wood that get from the forest. So I will show you what is the the importance of our activities in material recovery to help the deforestation issues and to help the MSW issues, to help all the issues of environmental. And this is some video I took from the star. Is the is a disposal of agriculture waste from
farmers in
mainly
Kedah
from
and
paddy
are
farming.
Burning their paddy fields to get
paddy
rid
fields.
Of pests.
They are basically it's a disposal, easiest disposal of
the
agriculture
although
waste.
They are not allowed to do it, but Kedah Agricultural Committee Chairman Datuk Suraya Yaakob says burning rice fields after a harvest is the fastest way to kill off all the insects and fungal spores before the next planting.
This is
the fires
this
that
is
the
a material basically
have
very
a tendency
important
to
for
go out of control.
As
nowadays, Malaysian Agriculture Research and Development Institute
maybe,
station manager Omar
start
Ismail
to
says dried paddy
stalks
the left
on the
field
of this,
are usually
material.
Burnt as it is
but
the most cost-efficient method.
The other country like Indonesia
State
will follow Malaysia, but
Chairman,
again,
Dr. Leong
maybe
Yong
in
Gong
Indonesia
says,
also
are
the awareness start to increase.
Under the supervision of an agriculture officer.
All right, material for future sustainability, smart material recovery, waste material and waste to energy. Basically, technology is started our initiative to help the environment, Malaysia especially, in from our first pilot project in Kuantan. We basically, our project is mainly in landfills. So we do a landfill mining where we excavate all the material from the landfill back to his origin. For example, like plastics, metal, glass, and rubber, soil, compost, and so on. So as you know that, the operation in landfill is they are keep receiving the MSW from industry and also from the from the domestic waste. From the housing and the areas except the industries area. So the only thing that they will do is only dump except inside the landfills. So what we are doing is we excavate back the landfills and we do a separation. Here is the treatment process where we remove the odor, we remove the pathogen and we remove the moisture and reduce up to 20 to 30% of the moisture content. So it's quite easy. This project launched with a very minimal investment where most of the equipment is actually ready inside the landfill area. So we have the excavator, we have the bulldozer, we have the truck inside the landfill that we can leverage to start our project. So at initial on the treatment process, we don't need very sophisticated machinery because we are using the biochemical or bioculture to remove and dry the material. There are three ways of to drying the material. One is the biochemical and the other thing is chemical and also mechanical. Mechanical, we need a very high initial investment and also very high costs in terms of operational and also chemical, maybe less for initial investment, but it's not good for the environment. But bioculture is the best, where the initial cost for the initial cost to start the project is very less and also environmental friendly. All right. And also it's quite robust technology, where we can treat the material up to 500 ton a day by one excavator. And if let's say we want to increase the treatment, we just increase the numbers of excavator and also the people that actually work inside. All right, maybe you can just show.
Target untuk buat 2 windrow, 3 windrow ada. Pukul 4, masih tak siap lagi.
Alright, so initially we start with very simple equipment to do a separation. But in 2022, we can have a more modern machinery. But things that we want to show to the public is we can do the separation using a very simple mechanical machinery. But of course, it is in terms of economical, will not not much on the. I think in terms of economical. Especially for initial investment, is at par lah without any profit. But if you want to make it more sustainable, we have to start at least 50 ton a day, where this machine can work at 5 ton a day separation. So what we can have from the separation, as I said, we can separate back the material back to this origin material. For example, like we can get some 5% of 3D plastic, the other 40% and 50% of soft plastic. And the other thing is compost. Where we can get compost is from the organic material that turn into compost. It's also is a byproduct from the bio or EM process from the fermentation to remove the pathogen, remove the odor, and also to dry the material. The byproduct is the compost. There here is the compost we got from the process. And quite significant numbers of textile and also the diapers in landfills. We can get metal, and this is the windrows after the separations. So and then things that basically important from the separation is to ensure that the quality of the metal is accessible for the process of recycling. We can from here before and after, what we want to show is we can clean the material, because from the separation and also the treatment process, the material is start to dry, and all the organic material such oil and all our food will turn into compost, and it's quite easy to wash the material. And this one is PP plastics. You can see right and left is right is more cleaner than the left one, but because of we just clean the soil, we don't need to clean all the oily material and from our food, because it's all turned into to soil or compost. right? And before and after, you can see it's very clean material, PE. All right, it's easy to do a recycling. And basically, landfill mining or smart material recovery is not new in the world. It's done. There are some projects done in Thailand. Here is a project in Thailand. Also in Mumbai. Okay, this one is in Thailand. In US and Canada, from India. India is a have a very good a profile in terms of landfill mining or smart material recovery, where they are developing the Bollywood too from the landfill. They are excavate around 8,000 tons a day to clear up land of, I'm not really sure, but if I'm not mistaken, is 200 hectare of land full with the from full with waste. Okay, and this is a material that we basically should have is a metal, rubber, glasses, plastic, and organic fertilizer. So our projection into 2022 is we can sort around make a separation of 120 ton of waste per day, and in 2023 500 ton per day, 300 ton per day. In 2025 is 600 ton per day. So the impact of the separation, we can see from the total space clearance. From the excavation process, for example, 200 ton a day, we can clear up to 28,800 meter cube of land space. Is in total after 2025, 635,000 clearance of meter cube. And it's equivalent to 63 hectometers. So imagine that every 1 meters, we can clear up the land space for 63 hectometers, right? So this is impact we want to show. And as I said, in Kuantan, 60 hectare of land allocated for landfill. We can imagine that in these 4 years, we can clear up all these 63 hectometer of landfill of the MSW. All right. For process, this is a process. We do a separation. A treatment process, and the second one is a separation. From the separation process, we can get the compost, recyclable material, the biofertilizer, inert light from the construction waste, and also RDF. Right? From this, we can generate all this material, and also for usage of plastic processing, agriculture, and also for energy plant. In our case, we already found the, we have a discussion with a potential off-taker, especially to off-take our plastic up to 2024, they require around 100 tons per day of plastics. So it's a very promising. We hope that in 2024, we will increase our production for up to 500 tons per day separation. So as I said, we hope in 2022, we will have more sophisticated machinery. So things that I want to show to the rest of our students and also lecturers is opportunity in this smart material recovery, especially in design of the machines, regardless in civil engineering, chemical, mechanical, or maybe in electricity and so on, and also transportation. So this is some ideas of the mechanical separation that we will have in 2022, hopefully, or maybe in 2023. Maybe we will have a smaller separation in 2022, and we will increase up to 500 tons per day in 2024. This is all the equipment that is necessary in our separation process. If you can see, it's quite rugged mechanical equipment, because it's basically it's nothing like we have 10 years or maybe 20 years R&D. So we just require maybe 1 year R&D or maybe 1 year planning to design to build the machinery. So we just require some Trommel, separation conveyor, and we can just buy the bulldozer, forklift, lorry, excavator, and we can just have a develop the silo, except the washing and shredding. We may need some research so that we can optimize the process, right? And this is some idea of how we do the landfill reclamation or smart material recovery from the feeding of conveyor until we can get the RDF, we can get the compost, and we get the plastics, right? These are some ideas what the project will. This is from our partners from India. It's a separation machine that one is the important machine is our Trommel to separate organic and non-organic. So, and then the next process is the refining the material, where if you will have a smaller fraction of up to 20 millimeters, yeah. So from here, we can separate all material like plastic, material like glass, metal, and compost easily, right? And of course, we need to treat the material first to remove the pathogen, to remove the odor, and also to dry the material. Here is the material that we will use for our downstream business, downstream product. Maybe I can show after this what is the material that we can generate from this material produced from this activity. And of course, organics material or compost is very important for our agriculture. And here is our RDF, plastic, light plastic and peanut, that we can turn into RDF. It's a fuel material or refuse derived fuel. All right. Okay, so what we can see is from this value chain, from the smart material recovery, is from the separation we can get the recyclable material such plastic, metal, rubber, and the other thing is a compost for agriculture and construction material, and the other thing is for RDF, for cement plant, energy plant, syngas, plastic to fuel, methanol, DME, or maybe jet fuel. These all things that basically require CV, calorific value, and also the others parameters such as elements of carbon and so on. So we can use the RDF for all these applications. And what we can see from here is the multiplying of the multiplying effect from the process. Is from the plastic, we can have a WPC, we can have the others materials or the others product, plastic product, as we can mention all the plastic product right now is, it must have the 30% recycled material or recycled resin inside. It's a new regulations from the EU to have at least 30% to make sure that this material or a product is sellable in EU, right? I think Malaysia will follow, and maybe some other countries also will follow the standard, right? Okay, these are some product that we can develop. For example, like downstream product, the first is like WPC, wood polymer composite. We can replace our wood from the plastic, and of course it is a mixture of 30% plastic and also 70% fiber, like rice husk, as we can see it at this earlier slide. The farmer burn, but we can take all the rice husk to create this WPC. There are many applications that we discover and recover. First is we already designed this chicken coop, reban ayam, and for finishing of the finishing, especially for our lantai and so on. And then untuk kita punya dinding, also kita punya also usage for finishing lah, untuk rumah punya finishing. And here is a composite pallet, alright. And from the plastic as well, for example, like Adidas, they already promote their shoes from bottle, especially from the ocean bottle. And then from the resin, we can produce many products such as this pallet, construction material, like this cone, and then for housings, and I think because of China is the most the biggest importer of the plastic, we can see many plastic in our kedai eco, and also it's all from China. So we can expect that this plastic also contain the recyclable resin, right? And then here is the virgin plastic. So please don't misunderstanding. Here is a plastic, not stone or maybe any. So from here is the plastic to plastic is that this is the very potential customer. In 2024, they will turn all the plastic back to the origin, like fuel or maybe a virgin plastic and so on. Here is some snapshot of global trade flow polyethylene, and so I don't need to present a lot of this. But things that I want to show is we have a new hope to get the material back to the origin, so that we can reuse back more than one time, two time, three time until the end of life of the plastics. All right. The RDF, refuse derived fuel, is from the MSW as well. We can use this for our cement plant, for our energy plant, and to generate the hydrogen and so on. So here is the actual cement plant in Indonesia. I'm not really sure, but if I'm not mistaken, in Ipoh, the cement plant. Especially Lafarge already imposed the to use the RDF for their clinker and to dry the cement, right? Here is the coal, world coal consumption. Malaysia is at number 24. Malaysia import 32 million ton of. Is it 32 million? It's a 33 billion, right? 33 billion metric, what is MCF? But, okay, I missed this MMCF. I don't know what how to convert it. But Malaysia is 24 million, 33 billion. MMCF and consume 0.4 from the world consumption, and for cubic feet per capita is around 1 million. All right, I have an opportunity to visit the energy plant in Negeri Sembilan. It's a coal energy plant. It's a huge plant. The consumption of the coal is around 70,000 metric ton within 3 days. So imagine that this ship will park here every 3 days. I mean every 4 days. So one ship go out, and then that the ships go in to supply the coal. So we can replace this coal with our RDF, or at least we can compensate the coal numbers using our RDF, right? Very huge potential by replacing the coal to RDF, right? And the other application is the plastic. We can turn into a green fuel. This is my opportunity to work with one company in Terengganu. They are producing diesel from plastic. And of course, from the byproduct also can use for our agriculture. We accessing in the seedling business where Malaysia's oil palm germinated seeds production is approximately 50 to 60 million seed every year. So approximately 148 seed per hectare and 5.865 million hectare is replanting every year. So from these numbers, what we can see is utilization of compost up to 50 million ton required to cover this seedling from the oil palm germination, right? So it's a very good opportunity for us to work with these seedling companies where the supply of 50,000 metric ton, or we can say around 50,000 metric ton, or maybe per year, and so with generation 50,000, we can divide into 330 days. Approximately is around 100 to 200 ton a day of compost from the production, right? Is it? Yeah. Maybe someone can help me to divide from 50 meter ton to 330 days. Right. And the other opportunity that we are working is also replanting of forest. So in 2030, we are targeting to replant the forest up to, not second, but we are targeting to replant 1 million ton. 1 million trees in 2030. 100 million, sorry. 100 millions of trees we're targeting to replant, but of course from the market, from the share of the 100 million, maybe we can target, we can maybe 20% of the from the effort, equivalent to maybe 20 million for to replant the forest. I mean, replant the tree for forest. So all this basically we consume our compost, where introduction of chemical fertilizer may be not suitable for forest forestry, okay, forestation activity. I think that's all. I think we still have maybe around 30 minutes for question and answer. But yeah, Dr. Noraini, Dr. Aini.
Thank you very much, Encik Haiza. So any questions from the participant, you can ask through the chat box or you may open your microphone. Encik Haiza, we know that from the landfill, there are a lot of types, many types of waste.
Yeah.
But how do we consider that the waste is potential for a sustainable material? Do you have any criteria or how you categorize the waste as a sustainable material? Sorry.
All right. Thanks, Doctor. Basically, it's a step-by-step process to identify that is the sustainable material. Reason why I say that, because, for example, like rubber, like small debris or microplastics, and also from the material from the construction and so on, it's a step-by-step process to utilize it. It depends on the demand from the industry. So that is the reason why we start the project, so that the industry start to open eyes from importation of the plastics from abroad to local content. That the, for example, like plastics, even PVC, right now we don't have that demand, but with the numbers of PVC we can get from the landfill, it will open another opportunity to utilize back the PVC. But as I said, it's a step by step. Right now we only covered in term material such as plastics, the compost and the RDF. Okay, for the RDF, we can use a textile, we can use the wood, and also we can use some of the compost to increase the high increase the calorific value. So from that, basically, the only we cannot we cannot do, or maybe we have to throw back to the landfill, it's just like PVC, maybe APS, or we can stockpile by hoping that there is an industry that require the material. So we can target up to 80 to 90% of material we recovered can be recycled. But it's a process, process by process, or we need that four times to encourage the industry to use the material. And in fact, compost, even though Malaysia import around 4.5 million ton of fertilizer, so we still need to create a demand. There's not per se, okay, we just replace the fertilizer. We still need to create the demand to use the compost. And anyway, because the industry previously is not ready yet to supply the compost except from this mesh production. So it takes time for the industry to turn from the fertilizer using the fertilizer from chemical to organic fertilizer. It's a step-by-step process.
So the materials that you mentioned is all from the landfill, right?
Yeah, the current activities in landfill, but we also ventures into material source. What I'm trying to say is, instead of landfill, we go to the material source. For example, like we do in Selangor, we try work with KDB and also MBSJ to collect their material before it goes to landfill. So they bring to our facility and we do a separation, and those for those that unrecycle, or maybe we is maybe because the facility is not complete yet, so maybe some we need to throw back to the landfills lah. But at least we can target 20 to 50% we can recover from our process.
Okay, thank you, Encik Haiza. So we have one question from the participant, from Dr. Linda. How do we determine the types of recovered materials can be used for what purpose?
All right, this is a quite it's quite challenging for us as well, because we need, as I said, it's a step-by-step process. We need to promote this material to industries to change from the import material to local material, and from the virgin source to the recycled material. It's quite challenging for us, especially like, as I said, like compost, even though Malaysia require around 4.5 million tons, but it's challenge for us to change the mindset, to change from the urea to compost. So from the question, as of now, it's very hard for me to determine, but it's a process to promote. That's the reason why we need universities, we need the government agencies, we need all the local PPT and so on to help us to promote the material. It's not a one-day job.
That's right.
Yeah.
Encik Haiza, just now you show some of the products, the finishing, the tiles. So what about the safety and also from aspect the cost, the economy cost?
All right. In terms of the economy
of
scale.
Because it's from the waste, right?
Yeah. Because our economy of scale, it really depends on the incentive from the government. It's not about in terms of money, but the incentive to ensure that we can get a very low cost of the for example, like we need to use around 1 kilogram of EM, sorry, 2 kilogram of PM for each of 20 tons of material. So it's a cost for us. Right now, we have to import the material. So from the incentive from the government to lower down the duty, for example, will help us to decrease the cost of the operation, so that it's much easier for us to promote the material. For example, like right now, we are targeting plastics material we can generate from the process is around 70 cents per kilo or 700 ton per ringgit, where the importation of the plastic right now is the cost is up to 1 ringgit 50 cent, or maybe up to 2 ringgit, depends on the type of material. So it's still relevant for us to in this project, but if we need to increase the demand for the local plastic, we have to reduce the cost.
So there's incentive for the industry part.
Yeah, it's a support from industry as well. From the industry as well.
So what about the consumer? Did the consumer also benefit from the program, from the incentive program?
Definitely, consumer will get the benefit. But I'm not really sure in terms of pricing, because mm-hmm. it depends on the final products. For example, like it depends on the quality, depends on the technology used to create the product. But when it comes to consumer, the very huge potential from this is the environmental. So we can save the environmental problem, we can reduce the GHG emission, we can reduce the problem of pollutions in from landfills, and of course it will affect the surrounding people, and also not just only surrounding, but because of this a national problem, the mm-hmm. effect is also in terms of economy. For example, like to close one landfill, it will cost around 15 million to the government. So if we can prolong the landfills, and also, or maybe we can eliminate the closure of the landfill, then it will save a lot of money for the government. And in terms of safety, of course, there is a safety measure that we have to take in, during the operation, but landfill is already not safe area. It create a lot of pollutions. It create a lot of air pollution, water pollution, and land pollution. It's already not a safe area already. But presence of us inside the landfill will help to reduce the risk and to make it a safe area. Yeah.
One question from Dr. Mimi. What are the technologies available to convert waste to wealth or treating the waste?
Okay, as I mentioned, there's three major process to treat the material. One is using the mechanical, the second one is using a chemical, and the third is using bioculture. So in terms of technology, is very subjective, but and it's subjective in the sense of acceptance of cost of cost to separate, and also cost for the off-taker. For example, like maybe in EU, it's very acceptable for them to have the mechanical drying. For example, because the disposal cost is higher than recycle the material. But in Malaysia, is the landscape may be different, because the enforcement and incentive from the government is quite less here. So we cannot get many incentive to reduce the cost. And also when it comes to technology, it's also quite limited here because we are still dependent on the, for bioculture, we still dependent on the importation. Here in Malaysia, there are universities that actually work on that. In fact, I know that Maldi also work on that, but they have no mesh production of EM in Malaysia for us to use. So right now, it really depends. Except the separation, we can work with universities. Except the downstream business, also, downstream product also, we can work with universities. For example, like to produce the hydrogen, there are some universities that actually already work on that. RDF also, there are some universities work on that. But when it comes to industrial scale, so we still need to work with the other industrial player to develop for us. Hopefully, government will put some incentive to develop this kind of at least a transfer of technology, which later on our graduate be able to design and develop this kind of technology. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Another question from the participant. How many percent can this technology recover the material from the landfill? And the second question, this is also the question that I want to ask. What is your opinion on the incinerator technology in Malaysia?
Okay. In terms of percentage, I can say is up to 80 to 90%, as long as the material is able to separate. What I'm trying to say, for example, like PVC, ABS, all those contaminated material, as long as we can separate them, they will have a value. But it's a step by step, depends on the industry to accept it. But in terms of in terms of the separation and also process of treatment, we can say that we can save up to 90% of the material. For example, like construction material, we can reuse back to construction, or maybe we can crush. We can crush the material back and then goes back to the construction usage. And then for plastics, especially like HDPE plastic, like our shampoo bottle, or maybe from our packaging, we can make it resin and turn back into the product. So as I said, as long as we can separate and treat the material properly, then we can reuse back. Again, it depends on the industry to use it. But if the industry doesn't want to use it, then we have no choice to return back to the landfill. But we hope that in within in years, a few years now, few years time, the industry starts to divert to inquire more on the local or recycle or green material from the landfill or from the MSW waste. My opinion in terms of incinerator is basically the incinerator is just to dispose the material, not to recover the material. Because
you cannot get any sustainable material from incineration process?
There will no sustainable material except the ash. It depends on the efficiency of the incinerator to use to incinerate the material. But if the incinerator not efficient enough to incinerate the material, there will generate more ash. But of course, there will be the other application of ash, for example, like for agriculture and so on. But in terms of circular economy, we lose a lot and lose many opportunity to reuse the material, because end up our source of material will start to decrease, while recovering the material for another usage, the material is still there. But burning or dispose the material, we can just get electricity, and in terms of economic, incinerator is only can sustain with tipping fee, while we donate that tipping fee. But if the government want to give me the tipping fee, then we are very okay. But incinerator is really depends on the tipping fee, because the electricity generations is really is very limited up. It depends on the input. For example, like there is incinerator in Malaysia. The capacity is 1,000 ton per day, where they can able to generate around 20 megawatt megawatt a day. But as I said, it really depends on the input. If it unable to generate up to the target, there will the cost of the operation will drag them into a failure. So tipping fee will help them to.
So it depends on the input of the material.
Yeah, the input and also input and also tipping fee. There will no incinerator in Malaysia can work without tipping fee lah. I can say it's really hard to get the ROI from the electricity generation.
So incinerator is not a favorism in Malaysia. We can say, we can conclude like that.
I can say lah, but it's not about economy anyway. Mm-hmm. But most important is the environmental.
Because we
don't need our source turn into it's a dispose. We need to mm-hmm. turn into something valuable in future.
If we compare to developed country or more advanced country, do they prefer the one that you did or more to incinerator?
Basically, most of the incinerator companies start to shutting down the incinerator. But I don't know what numbers. But because of the awareness of the environmental and the circular economy, so MRF or recycling start to the demand for the recycling start to increase.
Small.
Yeah, but of course for the developed country, it's not just on incinerator. Incinerator, mm-hmm. as I say, it's just for disposal.
Mm-hmm.
But the electricity generation for developed country is really depends on the nuclear.
Okay.
So because the 20 megawatt from 1,000 ton per day,
mm-hmm.
For us, 1,000 ton per day, we can develop, I don't know, maybe 1,000 from the plastic. We can turn it, if they say we can use for we can use the plastic for WPC, maybe we can develop 1,000 of housing.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. We have another question from Dr. Nini. Apart from incinerator, there is microwave technology available for hazardous waste. What is your point of view on this technology?
Basically, for microwave, I'm not really familiar on the microwave. But as I said, having a investment for mechanical or maybe that microwave, slightly higher than initial investment will be higher than recovery material. Using a bio culture. That's in my comment lah. I don't know what is the others, but I can say the investment is quite high. Initial
This
investment.
microwave technology is a new technology.
That's why I'm not familiar. I'm not familiar
Okay.
with the microwave.
All right. So is there any question from the participant? So Encik Haiza, you originally from computer science engineering, and then you jump into another different field. So what is your motivation actually?
Sustainability is not new for me because I already joined NGO for sustainability since 2000, 2010. I mean, back to 12 years ago. So I met Haji Asmadi. Very thanks to Allah. I met Dr. Haji Asmadi in 20 around 2014. And then from that we start to I mean I mean we start to
Library.
explore in this sustainability area. As I said, 2017 I got an opportunity to join the NCOP. So that is the bottom line. I mean the first opportunity I got in real sustainable activities lah.
Okay. Thank you, Encik Haiza, for sharing your experience. So I think no more question from the participant. Before we end our session, we will have a quick photo session.